Along with the development of technology and information, Universitas Terbuka provides the best services for its students. UT presents one of the superior applications called MyUT. MyUT application is here to make it easier for students to get various information related to learning processes. MyUT application has implemented single sign-on technology, or SSO. This application is an authentication service system to assist students in signing into a site or application. With this new system, students only need to sign in with an Office 365 account to enter various applications at once. Students can see personal dashboards through MyUT, including student data and academic development. In this scenario, students will have access to their payment status and a record of their courses. Additionally, they will also be able to access the following features: announcement and academic calendar, relevant information that can easily be accessed from WhatsApp and students' email, easy payment because it has implemented cash and card payment processor or 2C2P technology. Another facility MyUT offers is that students can directly enter online tutorial pages, webinar tutorials, and practicum practices without signing into their respective applications. Likewise, with other services such as registration, teaching materials, examinations, student activities, and graduation, students only need to select the desired services and will automatically enter the desired application. It is also equipped with a chatbot feature to make it easier for students to support their learning process. MyUT also offers other benefits to UT students, including assistance to students in finding exam locations through the examination participant card feature, which seamlessly integrates with exam location maps specific to each UT regional office. The website-based and mobile-based MyUT make it easier for students to get services anywhere and anytime.
The Asian Association of Open University proudly presents The Book of Open and Distant Education in Asia. Good Practices from AAOU Members. This book was collaboratively written by 8 members of AAOU. Korea National Open University. Open University Malaysia. Sukhothai Tamarirat Open University. The Open University of China. The Open University of Japan. The Open University of Sri Lanka. University of the Philippines Open University. And Universitas Terbuka.
The Asian community has long placed a high value on education. Education has always been seen as the catalyst for social welfare, upward social mobility, as well as human well-being. And nowadays, Asia has emerged as the major distance education providers as well as beneficiaries.
Dear colleagues, this book of Open and Distant Education, or ODE in Asia, is an important contribution from AAOU members and dedicated to the global ODE field. It will be continued in subsequent series and is anticipated to enrich references to ODE practices.
Welcome to the Asian Association Open Universities Conference at Allama Iqbal Open University. Pakistan is a land of rich panorama. It has marvelous diversity in culture. Stunning Himalayas and gushing waters constitute the geographic splendor of the land. Islamabad is one such place of beauty, and the Allama Iqbal Open University is located at the heart of the city. The Allama Iqbal Open University was founded in 1974 to open fresh avenues in the lives of people through distance education. Only in a couple of decades, the globe became a replica of the system. Today, open universities operate in the world. Being a pioneer institution in Asia, the Allama Iqbal Open University hosted the Asian Association Open Universities Conference. And now we earnestly prepare to wish all of you a warm welcome again. Every possible measure is being taken to make the international event constructive and comfortable. The conference website has been developed to facilitate registration, queries, and contact. Wi-Fi system is available in the campus for continuous communications. Central Library and Digital Library services will also be available for consultation and reference. To make your stay more comfortable, arrangements are being made in the hotels of international chains. You will be served with a variety of foods, especially the Oriental foods, with a blend of spices that will add to your taste. Visits to sites of cultural heritage would make a part of exciting tourism. Domestic handicrafts and products will be your shopping content for family and friends. The Allama Iqbal Open University is making all-out efforts to groom technology-oriented human resource through information and communication technology. Electronic and cyber communication formats are applied in teaching methodology. High-tech electronic software is produced in the Institute of Education Technology. These radio and television programs support the academic content of the university courses. The Center for Instructional Design has recently been established to develop electronic courseware for various programs. The student-centered arrangements also include campus radio, online learning, and educational television. Print materials like books, study guides sent by mail, tutorial instructions, face-to-face sessions in clusters of sciences in laboratories, group training workshops, faculties, and academic program. 35 academic departments of 4 faculties offer 104 programs of studies ranging from secondary level programs to research-based MPhil and PhD programs. The Allama Iqbal Open University ranks among mega universities in the world. We firmly believe in sharing experiences to innovate new structures in distance education. Together, we can enrich the existing practices and explore viable possibilities in education of technology, engineering, agriculture, and medical sciences in open distance learning framework.
The development of technology and information, Universitas Terbuka provides the best services for its students. UT presents one of the superior applications called MyUT. MyUT application is here to make it easier for students to get various information related to learning processes. MyUT application has implemented single sign-on technology, or SSO. This application is an authentication service system to assist students in signing into a site or application. With this new system, students only need to sign in with an Office 365 account to enter various applications at once. Students can see personal dashboards through MyUT, including student data and academic development. In this scenario, students will have access to their payment status and a record of their courses. Additionally, they will also be able to access the following features: announcement and academic calendar, relevant information that can easily be accessed from WhatsApp and students' email, easy payment, because it has implemented cash and card payment processor, or 2C2P technology. Another facility MyUT offers is that students can directly enter online tutorial pages, webinar tutorials, and practicum practices without signing into their respective applications. Likewise, with other services such as registration, teaching materials, examinations, student activities, and graduation, students only need to select the desired services and will automatically enter the desired application. It is also equipped with a chatbot feature to make it easier for students to support their learning process. MyUT also offers other benefits to UT students, including assistance to students in finding exam locations through the examination participant card feature, which seamlessly integrates with exam location maps specific to each UT regional office. The website-based and mobile-based MyUT make it easier for students to get services anywhere and anytime.
The Asian Association of Open University proudly presents The Book of Open and Distant Education in Asia. Good Practices from AAOU Members. This book was collaboratively written by 8 members of AAOU. Korea National Open University. Open University Malaysia. Sukhothai Tamarirat Open University. The Open University of China. The Open University of Japan. the Open University of Sri Lanka, University of the Philippines Open University, and Universitas Terbuka.
The Asian community has long placed a high value on education. Education has always been seen as the catalyst for social welfare, upward social mobility, as well as human well-being. And nowadays, Asia has emerged as the major distance education providers as well as beneficiaries.
Dear colleagues, this book of Open and Distant Education, or ODE in Asia, is an important contribution from AAOU members and dedicated to the global ODE field. It will be continued in subsequent series and is anticipated to enrich references to ODE practices.
Welcome to the Asian Association Open Universities Conference at Allama Iqbal Open University. Pakistan is a land of rich panorama. It has marvelous diversity in culture. Stunning Himalayas and gushing waters constitute the geographic splendor of the land. Islamabad is one such place of beauty, and the Allama Iqbal Open University is located at the heart of the city. The Allama Iqbal Open University was founded in 1974 to open fresh avenues in the lives of people through distance education. Only in a couple of decades, the globe became a replica of the system. Today, open universities operate in the world. Being a pioneer institution in Asia, the Allama Iqbal Open University hosted the Asian Association Open Universities Conference and now we earnestly prepare to wish all of you a warm welcome again. Every possible measure is being taken to make the international event constructive and comfortable. The conference website has been developed to facilitate registration, queries, and contact. Wi-Fi system is available in the campus for continuous communications. Central Library and Digital Library services will also be available for consultation and reference. To make your stay more comfortable, arrangements are being made in the hotels of international chains. You will be served with a variety of foods, especially the Oriental foods, with a blend of spices that will add to your taste. Visits to sites of cultural heritage would make a part of exciting tourism. Domestic handicrafts and products will be your shopping content for family and friends. The Allama Iqbal Open University is making all-out efforts to groom technology-oriented human resource through information and communication technology. Electronic and cyber communication formats are applied in teaching methodology. High-tech electronic software is produced in the Institute of Education Technology. These radio and television programs support the academic content of the university courses. The Center for Instructional Design has recently been established to develop electronic courseware for various programs. The student-centered arrangements also include campus radio, online learning, and educational television. Print materials like books, study guides sent by mail, tutorial instructions, face-to-face sessions in clusters of sciences and laboratories, group training workshops, faculties, and academic program. 35 academic departments of 4 faculties offer 104 programs of studies ranging from secondary level programs to research-based MPhil and PhD programs. The Allama Iqbal Open University ranks among mega universities in the world. We firmly believe in sharing experiences to innovate new structures in distance education. Together, we can enrich the existing practices and explore viable possibilities in education of technology, engineering, agriculture, and medical sciences in open distance learning framework.
Okay, a very good morning from Jakarta, Indonesia. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Rahmat Budiman, Secretary General of the Asian Association of Open Universities. Dear participants, I would like to announce that this very first webinar is again conducted by the AAOU Secretariat to enrich and also to give assistance to all the members of the AAOU. Particularly in this year, we will invite the students in bachelor degree program, in master's, and also in PhD or in doctoral programs to participate in the webinar series. This year, we are going to enrich them how to prepare writing an academic paper, how to produce a quality thesis, dissertation, and also academic journal paper. The first webinar that we are holding today as a roadmap to successful publication. It will be followed by 10 to 12 other lecture series. And once again, for you who have registered today, do not forget to re-register at the next webinar series. And once again, on behalf of the AAOU Secretariat, I would like to thank the speakers, Dr. Tirumani from OUM, University Open, Open University of Malaysia, Professor Gorky Sembiring from Sembiring, and also our moderator, Dr. Mubashara from Allama Iqbal Open Universities. From our registration form, currently we have 350 participants, and we hope that the rest will be joining us soon. Without further ado, I would like to invite the president of the AAOU and also director of Universitas Terbuka to deliver the opening remarks. The president, the screen is yours. Thank you.
Good morning, my dear AAOU members and friends. How are you doing on this lovely day? I'm pleased to greet you again on this bright and joyful new year. Upon this fresh beginning, let's hope for more fruitful and blessed day ahead. AAOU, as always, aims to share and provide unlimited insight and knowledge, particularly in the educational context of online and distant learning. We have witnessed how AAOU actively gives birth to webinars with various topics and themes for the past few years. It gives us pleasure to be able to keep this program going from time to time, knowing many of you could take benefit of it. As a scholar, we eventually indulge ourselves in creating academic writing, especially for students who start to enter higher education level. Academic publications become more crucial for students in higher level of education, because it's a must for them to write a research article in order to accomplish their educational degree and certainly contribute to students' development. Upon this consensus, in the hope to encourage those our students, our colleagues who are working on their postgraduate or graduate study, this time, AAOU initiates this new program called AAOU Lecture Series, and will take the first approach on the current issues in the global educational research paradigm. Please let me welcome our respected keynote speakers. First, Professor Maximus Gorky Sembiring, the professor at Universitas Terbuka and former Secretary General of AAOU from 2008 to 2010. Good morning, Prof. It's nice to see you again. We are always excited to hear your invaluable insights. Our second speaker, Dr. Thirumeni Subramaniam, Associate Professor from Open University Malaysia, who is known to have involved herself much with research, AAOU Journal Editorial Board, and publications. Good morning, Dr. Thiru. Welcome to join us here today. Hope you are enjoying our session today. Last but not least, the main character who will take lead of our general lecture today, our moderator, Dr. Mubushera Tufail from Allama Iqbal, Open University Pakistan. Warmest welcome to you, and it's lovely to see you today. Dr. Mubushera, we trust this session getting fruitful under your maneuver. Our dearest participants, both of our speakers today have made numerous publications and are the expert of their own. I encourage all of you to be actively engaged during the sessions. Observe as much knowledge as possible and take some more insight from their expertise today. Keep yourself seated with some good snacks nearby. Thanks for taking the time to attend our lecture. Stay happy and healthy. Have a nice one.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. President. Before we continue to the next session, once again, I would like to highlight that in 2024, this program, the webinar lecture series, is dedicated to students in bachelor degree, master's degree, and PhD program, and also to all academicians and everyone who are interested in producing academic papers. This lecture series is for you. So we would like to invite that please register until the end of the series, and so that you will know how to begin your research article until you publish it in a reputable journal. Dear participants, I would like now to introduce our moderator today, Dr. Mubushera Tufail, lecturer from Department of Early Childhood Education, and Elementary Teachers Education from Alama Iqbal Open University, who is going to host our conference this year. From the papers we receive, that at the moment, Dr. Mubesha Tufail is working at the Department of Early Childhood Education and Elementary Teacher Education, Alama Iqbal Open University, Islamabad. Her PhD degree is obtained from National University of Modern Language, Islamabad. And I would like to mention that her GPA is 4.0, is remarkable. And then working experience since 2000, from August 2016 up to today, she is a lecturer at the Department of Early Childhood Education and Elementary Teacher Education, Alama Iqbal Open University. In 2019, she has a scholarship from International Research Support Initiative Program, fellowship for Pennsylvania State University, University Park Campus, Pennsylvania. She has some awards. I would like to read once. In 2020, the first place in journal article qualitative by Division of Distance Learning of Association for Educational Communication and Technology for sustaining students' motivation in e-learning system, Pakistan Journal of Distance and Online Learning. This is the award, and then she has some professional trainings and then also some publication. I cannot read because there are so many, but I'm very sure that Dr. Mushera Tufail is the right person to lead the discussion because he has also an experience and also expert in distance education. And before we continue, I would like to highlight the project she conducted. For example, in 2019, April, member of the content development team. And then in December 2020 to June 2022, co-principal investigator. The project is development of tool development, data analysis, and report writing of project scope of services of Alama Iqbal Open University, a study of students' perspective by Alama Iqbal Open University. And then the current project from February 2022 to March 2023, a subject expert in redefining literacy in digital era by Alama Iqbal Open University in collaboration with Japan International Cooperation Agency or JICA, advancing quality alternative learning program and team, and CHD implementing partner. She has some publications, and then I'm sure that if you find in Google Scholars, her publication will appear easily. And then I would like to highlight the newest one. For example, the latest one published in 2024, Professional Development Work on Global Citizenship Education, Experience of University Teachers, published in CISGA Research Journal. And the second one is written with Malik S., analyzing the social skills of students at early childhood education level and the role of school personnel, published in Quantic Journal of Social Sciences. And also one publication published in this year, in last year, 2023, is Students' Assessment Practices at University Level, Comparing the Perspective of Teachers and Learners, published in Journal of Contemporary Trends and Issues in Education. There are some more publications that Dr. Mubeshera published. And once again, I would like to hand over the screen to Dr. Mubeshera to lead this lecture series. Dr. Mubeshera, the mic and also the screen is yours. Thank you. Yeah. Okay, Dr. Mubeshera?
Yeah.
Can you check the mic? Okay, we can hear you clearly. Thank you.
Okay. Can you please share the slides? Thank you. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to moderate this virtual event on this very important topic. As we are discussing current issues in global educational research paradigm, and we have two amazing speakers with us. Before proceeding to the speakers, I would like to mention some regulations about this webinar. First is, if you have any questions, then please send in the chat box with the following format, like write your name and then your country and then the intended speaker, because we have two speakers with us. So you can write the name of the speaker and then you can write your question. We will take your questions at the end of the speech of both speakers. These questions will be displayed on the screen, and we will discuss one by one all of these questions. And then I would like to remind again the respected participants that please fill out the registration form in advance. And if you have not filled it, just please do it and follow the program. Just listen to us and have your questions answered by the speakers. And by the end of this webinar, please do fill out the feedback form. After you fill out the feedback form available by the end of the webinar, then you will be able to get the certificate for this webinar. So yeah, I think we should proceed to introducing our speakers with us. So yeah, next slide, please. Okay, first we have Professor Maximum Gorky Sembiring with us, and he has a PhD in Educational Management from Universities Negeri Jakarta, Indonesia. And he is a certified research reviewer, certified public speaker, and he is a member of Academic Senate University Terbuka. He's a professor at University of Terbuka, and he's director at Research Center, director at Regional Center for OBC Students, Secretary General. He has also served as a Secretary General of Asian Association of Open Universities from 2009 to 2010. And he has also served as a Vice Director for Partnerships and Institutional Development at UT. So, sir, we welcome to this webinar. Thank you for giving us your time. Now we will have Professor Gorky with us for next 30 minutes. So, sir, over to you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you very much, dear colleagues, AAOU members. First of all, before I start to share my view on current issues and predictive futuristic in the global educational research paradigm. I would like to express my sincere appreciation to AAOU through the president and also the secretary general. As far as I can remember, that this is the fourth year we have a series, a very practical and very good series, how to help one another in the field of distance education. So let me start with by saying that as we envision the future of education, remember that the ultimate of research is not simply to gather knowledge, but to cultivate compassionate, curious, and resilient individuals equipped to shape a better world for future generation. As the president gave his introductory speech just now, that this is the appropriate place how we will try to shape our educational perspective viewed from research paradigm to prepare a better future generation. Okay, let me start with the outline of the presentation. I have five parts. First one, general textual overview, contextual elaboration from the textual overview, and further contextual elaboration to see the futuristic challenges in the global educational research paradigm. And then, before concluding the presentation later, there will be an elaborative contextualization, especially in seeing futuristic research gaps, themes, and possible topics in open, flexible, distant learning perspective. And there will be concluding remarks later on. And then we'll be following with discussion. So, educating for analytical digital literacy by redefining futuristic educational research for learners. This is the ultimate of these five parts that I will present and share with you all. Now, what would be the textual overview viewed from current issues in the global research paradigm? At least there will be an innovative solution. First one, and then it should be approached by interdisciplinary collaboration to see how we can produce or how the reproducibility and replicability will be in place. And don't forget that there should be an ethical consideration. This is the current issues in the global research paradigm to start with. And these four driving force, as a result of imbalance in research outputs and contribution throughout the country, throughout the world. So it is then imperative, or it is then critical for continuous adaptation and improvement. That's how we see the research paradigm viewed from textual overview. And then the second, as a background, current and futuristic challenges in the global educational research paradigm. We found recently that there is an issue of a digital divide and also evolving nature of technology. I think we acknowledge distance learning institution practitioners. And there's also a challenge in terms of pedagogical integration from offline learning into the online learning, especially forced by the pandemic starting from 2020. And then we also confront with inclusivity and diversity, and also cultural sensitivity. So we need to ensure equitable access to quality learning opportunities. That's the textual overview. If we see the current and futuristic challenge. And then, how, if we see that from a textual overview, related to futuristic research gaps, research possible research themes, and also research topics in open, flexible, distant learning perspective. So, we need to acknowledge about efficacy of emerging technology. There is also socio-cultural implication, scalable and sustainable models for example, open educational resources, or even MOOCs, for example, if you like, and long-term outcome on learner success. So we need to ensure the effectiveness and accessibility on a global scale so everyone will have the same access without discrimination. Now we see what would be the contextual elaboration from this textual, so we can see it from 10 perspectives. Let's say we see it from interdisciplinary collaboration, ethical consideration, reproducibility and replicability, and global imbalance in research output, open science and access to knowledge. This is the first part from 10 perspective, how we see current issues in the global research paradigm. And the second part, how about research funding and prioritization? And also related to science communication and public engagement, followed by global collaboration and amid geopolitical challenges. If you see, not only in the because of Ukraine and Soviet Union, for example, in every part of the world, as a country, for example, we have our own geopolitical challenges uniquely to each country. And also crisis responsive research. And the last but not least is diversity, equity, and inclusion. So what is the elaboration of this 10 perspective? Later on, if you have in your own time, you can see it by following one by one from the first up to the 10th in the following slides. But I won't explain all the 10, but I just want to share with you how to read those 10 perspectives. For example, if we see from the view of interdisciplinary collaboration, for example, what would be the issue here? The issue is traditional disciplinary boundaries often hinder collaboration on complex global challenges. So we have to find something new breakthrough as an elaboration that critical issues such climate change, for example, public health crisis and socioeconomic disparities require researchers from the diverse fields to work together. So in other words, we need research collaboration. Challenges include fostering effective communication, developing shared methodologies, and acknowledge the value of interdisciplinary contribution. That's how we see or how we read this 10 perspective. I've provided all of the explanation from 1 to 10 from the interdisciplinary collaboration, as just I read to you just now, ethical consideration, and up to the 10th, diversity, equity, and inclusion. Now, now we move to the third part, further contextual elaboration. What would be the current challenges if we see from digital divide, for example? So current challenge, if we see from digital divide, unequal access to digital resources and technologies among students. As the president speech just now about, this is not only for academic, as Pak Rahmat said also, it is not only for the academic staff, but also for, especially for students in bachelor, master degree, or even a PhD program. So we have to find out, as an elaboration, the digital divide exacerbates educational inequalities, hindering the ability of students in marginalized communities to access online learning resources and participate fully in digital classroom. So this is how we try to face current issues and predictive futuristic in the global educational research paradigm related to what would AAOU Lecture Series want to achieve as a road to successful publication. So this is how to write, how to read this presentation. In terms of current challenges, let's say digital divide, technology integration, educational inequalities, and also teacher professional development, assessment and evaluation, and also global crisis response. For example, let me see about the global crisis response. What would be the current challenge? We need to build resilience in educational system to respond to global crises such as pandemics or natural disaster. Because we just faced the pandemic, so we try to put it as a driving force. What is the current challenge in response to global crisis? So we need, for example, if we are talking about pandemic, so there will be approach, how the COVID pandemic highlighted the need for flexible learning models. Let's say from in Indonesia, for example, we move from totally offline learning into online learning. And it gives some complication or sophistication, if you like, when it comes to the implementation. So educational institution must be prepared to adapt quickly to unforeseen challenges without compromising learning outcomes. Means that we need approach through deep research, for example, so there will be no complication because we shift the learning process from offline into online learning. Now, let me see the futuristic challenge, for example. As I said just now, we are not only talking about current issues, but also predictive futuristic. So let me see from the new wave, yeah, about personalized learning. What would be the futuristic challenge? Developing effective personalized learning strategies at scale means that we have to put all the effort into the student as a center. So we need to find out, as technology advances, there is a growing emphasis on tailoring education to individual student needs. Challenges include creating adaptive learning platforms. And as we know now, we are familiar with so many platforms now, how to make the learning is very productive and also effective and also efficient. Addressing data privacy concerns, because this is also need to be taken into account cautiously, and ensuring equitable access to personalized resource. Now, in your own time later on, you may also elaborate further. What would be the other futuristic challenges see from lifelong learning? For example, AI and education, and also global collaboration in educational research, climate change education, as I show you in the first example just now, and also emotional intelligence and well-being. Now, this is interesting here. How we take into account about emotional intelligence and well-being, if the role of emotional intelligence and mental well-being in education, especially when it is offered through open, flexible distance learning, for example. So we need to recognize the importance of social emotional learning. Future educational paradigm should focus on nurturing students' emotional intelligence, resilience, and mental health to enhance overall well-being. Even though we are involved in OFDL, Open Flexible Distance Learning, anyhow, there should be an interaction multi ways. For example, whether it is face-to-face or through media. So the social engagement or emotional engagement, it helps much for student to be able to go through his or her study under OFDL. Now, we move to the elaborative contextualization. What would be the futuristic research gaps, themes, and topics in OFDL perspective? Now, I think I will spend 5 to 10 minutes here because this is very relevant what Pak Rahmat said just now as a Secretary General and the AAOU Secretariat, who wants to have a specific series under AAOU programs about a road to successful publication. So we are now discussing about current issues and predictive futuristic in the global educational research paradigm. Now, let's say the first. If we limit ourselves into a technological integration and impact, for example, what would be the research gap here? As technology continues to evolve, there is a need to explore the integration and impact of emerging technologies, such as artificial intelligence, virtual reality, augmented reality, and blockchain in OFDL environments, open flexible distance learning. So there are so many aspects that could be further inquired as a research teams for all of us. So if this is the research gap, for example, viewed from technological integration impact, so there will be some, at least three of them, as a research teams. For example, assessing the effectiveness of AI-driven personalized learning algorithm in OFDL. And the second, exploring the potential of virtual and augmented reality for immersive learning experiences. And then, investigating the use of blockchain for secure and transparent credentialing in OFDL. So, only by this one research gap, we may come up with at least three research themes. So, we have to be alert to the digital divide. Access to technology should not intensify educational disparities. So, from these themes, for example, we can later on make our own, let's say, specific topics for that. Now, what would be the specific topic for that? It depends on your background, for example. So I leave it to you. By having a research gap, as I said just now, in a technological integration impact with research teams as follows, and then you may freely find out by your own related to your background, related to your objective, and what results should be achieved in your research later on as a title of your research. And then how if we see it from social cultural implication, for example, let's say what would be the research gap if we try to view it from social cultural implication. Understanding the sociocultural dynamics of OFDL and its impact on diverse learner population, including consideration of cultural sensitivity, accessibility, and inclusivity. So, if we see it as a research gap, then at least we may come up with the following research themes. For example, how we try to examine the cultural adaptation of OFDL materials and assessment. That's if you are interested in from academic perspective, for example, how the materials should be developed and how we assess the material within the OFDL framework. And then we may also come up with how to investigate the role of social presence. Social presence means not only your our cognitive and teaching presence, but social presence and community building in virtual learning environments. If it is in the not virtual learning context, for example, let's say in the classroom or in the face-to-face interaction, there should be a different approach, how we investigate the role of social presence. And then the third, if we see it from social cultural implication, assessing the accessibility of OVDL for learners with diverse needs. I think if we have 10 students, it might have 11 or maybe at least less than 10 diverse needs. So how we see it from social cultural implication? So only from this the first two contexts, for example, technological integration impact and social cultural implication, we may come up with very many various themes. Of course, with various and many titles as well. And then how if we see that as a scalability and sustainability of OER, for example? So if we see it from scalability and sustainability, especially from OER perspective, so the research gap could be identifying scalable and sustainable models for the development, distribution, and maintenance of OER, but within the framework of open, flexible distance learning. So if this is the research gap, for example, maybe we come up with at least the following themes. Let's say analyzing the effectiveness of collaborative OER creation and curation platforms, investigating the economic and environmental sustainability of OER initiative, and exploring policies and frameworks that support the long-term viability of OER. So we have now three different perspectives with three different research gaps and also with various research themes and, of course, with so many research topics that will be available and also in line with students who is doing their papers for bachelor, for example, or for master degree or dissertation for PhD program. Now we see it from another side of viewing what would be another research gap. Let's say from long-term outcomes and learner success. I think whether we are in the mode of distant learning with OMDL, for example, or even face-to-face interaction, for example, long-term outcomes and learner success, I think we must put that as our priority. So if that's the case, so what would be the research gap viewed from long-term outcomes and learner success? So we need to assess the long-term educational and career outcomes of learners engaged in OFDL. For Universitas Terbuka context, for example, we have a specific KPI for that, including factors influencing learner success and retention. I prefer to use this is the persistence actually, but retention is okay as well. So they're not only able to retain what they study, but also they persist to pursue their degree up to the end. Not only stop in the middle of the jungle. And then if we see it as from long-term outcomes and learner success, for example, then we may come up with some research teams. Probably investigate the impact of OFDL on employability and career advancement. And this is we view this not only from academic perspective, but also post study at Universitas Terbuka, if in Indonesia or OUM in Malaysia, for example, or in Alam Iqbal, for example, in Pakistan, and also from other open university from each country as a member of AAOU. And then analyzing factors influencing learner motivation and persistence in OFDL. And assess the transferability of skill acquired through OFDL to real-world context. I think this is, in Indonesian context, for example, I think this is also relevant to your case, that transferability is the most sexy issue now, because there is no difference anymore between whether it is from offline or online campus, for example. It is not about face-to-face versus distant learning and so on. So transferability is a good or sexy topics if you want to see how long-term outcomes and learner success as a point of view to be researched further. And then how if we see it from pedagogical approach and teacher professional development? I will focus first on the pedagogical approach, for example. In 10 or 15 years ago, for example, in the past 10 to 15 years, in Indonesia, there is a doubt that not all of the study programs could be effective as traditional or face-to-face. Now, as we have a pedagogical revolution or evolution, if you like, there will be no difference between whether it is delivered to distance or delivered is in the face-to-face interaction, as long as we have an appropriate or transformative pedagogical approach. So, by saying so, the research gap would be how to examine evolving pedagogical approach in OFDL and the corresponding need for continuous teacher professional development to adapt to changing educational landscape. So by having this kind of research gap, for example, we may come up with research teams investigating effective strategy for online pedagogy and student engagement in OFDL. Why we put it online pedagogy here? Because if you refer to Siemens, for example, on connectivism, so it will assure us that there will be no problems in terms of effectivity online learning versus offline learning, as long as we may see or we may find appropriate or proper pedagogy approach in OFDL. And then also, we need to assess the impact of teacher training programs on enhancing digital literacy and online teaching skills, especially in the developing country like Indonesia, for example, with the archipelago countries. So it is still a problem how to have a teacher training program so it will be it will have the same quality throughout the countries. exploring the role of teachers as facilitators and mentors in OFDL environments. In other words, it is not a teacher who's someone that transfer knowledge to from one to another, but to facilitate and to mentor within the OFDL framework. I think this is the last one. If we see what would be the research gap if we see cross-disciplinary collaboration and global perspective. This is not only viewed from academic, operational, and other internal affairs, but how we see it from a much more global view. If we see it from the cross-disciplinary collaboration and global perspective, so the research gap would be encouraging cross-disciplinary collaboration in ODL research to address complex challenges and fostering a global perspective that considers diverse educational contexts. It implies that we need, under AAOU scheme, for example, all the members try to grasp a group of researchers to attack one problem from a field from not only from a different perspective, also from different cross-disciplinary collaboration related to the country itself. So if that's the case, so what would be the research themes? Facilitating collaboration between education, technology, and social science disciplines. Exploring cultural differences in the implementation and acceptance of ODL. Investigating the role of international partnership. I think AAOU initiate so many international partnership, not only amongst the member of AAOU, but also from other part of the world, not only from Asia countries, in the advancing OFDL research and practice. So, conducting comprehensive research in these areas will contribute to the ongoing evolution of OFDL, ensuring its effectiveness, accessibility, and sustainability. Three keywords: effectiveness, accessibility, and sustainability in meeting the educational needs for diverse learners globally, because we are talking about cross-disciplinary collaboration in the global perspective. Now, we start just now, we start from global research paradigm. The landscape is evolving rapidly, so we need interdisciplinary collaboration. And by having interdisciplinary collaboration, don't forget to take into account cautiously about ethical consideration, so that we are able to reproducibility of findings to mend a puncture where the puncture is imbalances output need inclusivity. So in other words, ensure the diverse voices contribute to the global scientific discourse, and this ultimately will foster a robust ecosystem in methodology and ethically conscious, transparent, and representative of the global community. And then, what would be the challenge? If we see the challenge in the first place, global educational research paradigm, the complexities are manifold, as I explained from the beginning. And then, how we bridge that? We see digital divide, for example, personalized learning for life, long education addressing the ethical implication of artificial intelligence in education and highlights the evolving nature of educational research. That's the bridge. And what would be the focus? So the focus would be pivotal role of educators, that's us, policymakers, researchers. This is also us. Policymakers means maybe the from the Ministry of Education, for example, in creating adaptive educational system responding to global challenges by prioritizing inclusivity, emotional well-being, sustainability. And last but not least, if you see the quote here, don't let the pursuit of innovation dominate the need for evidence-based practices. Balance creativity with rigor. Means that futuristic research gaps, themes, topics in ODL, we uncover a realm teeming with possibilities. Critical investigation into the integration of emerging technologies, sociocultural implication, and scalable models for OER are imperative, are important or critical. So we need to recognize the long-term outcomes of ODL and fostering cross-disciplinary collaboration on global scale that will shape the future of education as we expect, and also as I expect from the beginning when I start the presentation. So, If I may put the highlights, for example, so in terms of the text, we underscore the dynamism and interconnectedness of global research and education. That's the text. And then the context, confront ethical dilemmas, embrace technological advancement, and strive for education equity. And the contextualization, fostering a global research in harmony with the education community. And our ultimate remarks is adaptive, ethical, committed to addressing multifaceted challenges that shape better world. So be aware of the preferences in research orientation. Diversity and interactive leads to more inclusive understanding. This is some inspirational and further readings for you and also for me. And if you have some comment or suggestion how this current issue and predictive futuristic in the global education research paradigm would be make us better in preparing a successful publication in our own way. Thank you very much. Remember the human part. Empathy and understanding are as significant in research as they are in teaching. Once again, thank you very much. I give it back to Dr. Tufail.
Thank you very much, Professor Gorky, for your insightful presentation. I think it's giving us enough food for thought, like what are the possible options and areas to navigate through and work for our educational research plans and projects. So I would request Secretariat to display the slides, please. Okay, so now we are moving towards our next speaker. And before moving to the second half of the webinar, I would like to again read the webinar regulations for you. So please do ask questions in the following format, like write your name, mention your institution and country, and also write the name of the speaker, because we have two speakers with us. So I'll also write the name of the speaker to whom you're asking the question, and then you can write your question. So, we will answer your questions by the end of the webinar, and it will be displayed on the screen. And please do fill out the feedback form by the which will be available by the end of the webinar, and do ask your questions, actively participate in this event so that you can get the certificate by the end of the event. So yeah, thank you. I would like to next slide, please. I would like to introduce a speaker. Okay, Dr. Thirumani Subramanian is an academic with a wide research experience in the area of continuous and open education from curriculum design, content creation, delivery, and assessment. And she has her PhD in photonics technology from University of Malaya, Malaysia. And she is a coordinator for international relations, linkages, and commercialization at the Office of President, Vice Chancellor, Open University, Malaysia. And she's serving as an associate professor at the Faculty of Applied Sciences, Open University, Malaysia. And She has also served as a director at Center for Research and Innovation, Open University of Malaysia, from 2005 to 2023. And from 2003 to 2005, she was also research fellow in Photonics Laboratory, University Malaya. So we will have Dr. Thirumani with us for next 30 minutes. So Professor, over to you. Thank you. Please unmute yourself. Thank you.
Sorry about that. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Mubashira. Thank you to the AAOU Secretariat for inviting me for this session. And thank you for all the participants for attending this session. Now, I would like to introduce the presentation. Let me share my screen. And you can see. Okay. So, for this topic, in current issues in global research paradigm, I would like to take a slightly different approach because I think what we want to do is we would like you to look into the aspects that we need to consider, and that will allow you to arrive at your own research paradigm. So that way, the approach is slightly little different. And let me show the content. The content basically is separated by key concepts, very few key concepts. Then we will look into research outputs. Now, the reason for why I would like to look into or lead you through the research outputs, because when we want to do research, we need to know what is our obligations to the project that we are doing. I think that is important. And then we will look into global research paradigm and then the current issues. So for the key concepts, there are three major key concepts that I'd like us to consider. One is research. What is research all about? And one is research paradigm, and lastly, global research paradigm. So for research, there are many definitions here, and you can see this, if you look through the word research, you'll find many different terms, different people introduce it differently, different people from different fields have a different definition. But I think what is important is what is meaningful for you. Yeah, in that sense, for me, research is a detailed study of a subject involving creative and systematic methods or approaches undertaken in order to discover new information or reach a new understanding. Sometimes all this research will have to have an output, a meaningful outcome. So those are the other dimensions of a research. In that, we also need to understand what are the characteristics of the research. Number one, primarily, research has to be objective and unbiased, and it has to be guided by transparency and ethics. Now, if you have listened to Prof. Gorky, and I think Prof. Gorky have highlighted a lot of important key concepts, and we will see similar key words over his presentation and this presentation. Other than that, we also, research has to follow critical thinking and reasoning. Critical thinking is very important in order for you to read materials critically, to design your methods, to analyze your data critically, and reasoning is important to find out how the data that you have can be analyzed in order to come to important findings. So also, research has to be based on empirical evidences. Now, there are differences in this because it depends on the different research that you carry out. Nevertheless, data is important. Without evidence, you cannot prove that this study can be reproduced or not. Yeah? So the other features of research includes replicability and highly iterative, and finally, peer review. Sometimes you have questions like, oh, I could do research. I think I could, I don't really need a grant. That's a question sometimes a student may have. But research proposal must be peer reviewed so that it is defined or proven to be objective, unbiased, and has all these characteristics. Yeah, let's look into who are involved in research. Who's involved in research? You have research in academia, people in the industry conduct research, government conduct research, but the priorities are different. One of the most open priorities is in the world of academia, because then you can do research in areas that whether it's basic research, applied research, or it could also be experimental, innovative areas that we've not explored. Now, what informs your research paradigm? Foundation to all these questions is an understanding of philosophy. Some of us are lucky we learn or we have undergone a course in philosophy during our undergraduate years. But if you haven't, I think it's always interesting to read or get involved with philosophy, because understanding philosophy forms the opinion and the reasoning that you will have in order to arrive at your research paradigm. Basically, I would like to share the work of Ganyu and Egbu from 2018, who have outlined this whole transition very clearly. You start with ontology, which is the nature of reality, and that you can take different philosophy. It could be positivism, interpretivism, realism, pragmatism. These are different foundations that can inform your research eventually. But your choices depend on other factors. You know, we will look into that later. But you need to look into what is the nature of the reality. Then take a look at the epistemology, which means what constitutes the knowledge that you would like to contribute to. And then the axiology, the role of value. So here there are different criteria or characteristics of the different philosophy there are. You may use one, you may use two, but or more than one, you can integrate them. What is important here is the fact that you are able to have the foundation that allows you to think and then decide what are the characteristics that you like in your proposal. So that actually will inform your research methodology. And you can discuss this with your, if you are a student, then you can discuss this with your supervisor. If you're already a lecturer who are already involved in research, then you can, you already have these foundations and you could relook at some of the new philosophy in order to get, form your research methodology that you like to conduct. So in order to look into the current global research paradigm, we need to look into a few areas. Number one, research paradigm often differs for different fields. So it is field specific. And there are also the current global issues and concerns that we need to consider. And one of the common features that we find in today's world is transformational and also transdisciplinary. Transformational basically come about because of the era that we live in and the concern that we have on our global world in terms of our environment and in terms of the future. And transdisciplinary came about because of the complexity of the knowledge that we have in today's world and the integration that is necessary in order to for us to resolve or find solutions to many of the global issues that we have. Yeah? So here, I would like to explore or give it a thought about some other things that could also is a major influence to our research paradigm, the technology. In terms of technology, you may have many aspects, but what I like to have is that you have two pictures here. The two pictures just shows that sometimes you cannot just read one sources to find your information. You need to take a look at different ways of looking at things. Now, one of the future, these are technologies that's already existing, but in future will become more pertinent. And the artificial intelligence and machine learning, computer, human-computer interfaces, extended reality, 3D printing. And if you look into the world of industry, where Industry 4.0 is the current revolution, You have technologies that are smart sensors. And if you look into this, combined effect will be felt in any industry. Yeah? So smart sensors could also be used in education as well. You can also have, we also have advanced robotics, big data analytics, 3D printing, which is same thing on the other side. You have augmented reality, which is a different reality from in terms of extended reality. You have augmented reality. You also have virtual reality, mixed reality. All the terms are, it's just how you want to define the reality that you want to create. And we have cloud computing, which is a reality in today's world. And location detection, this is another technology that is important. And it allows a lot of different applications. And IoT, Internet of Things. But it's like error there. Okay. Now, this is the major focus of the presentation. As a researcher, once you have formed your research paradigm, you need to carry out your research, and then from the research, you have to have several outputs. Now, beforehand, having taken a look at the program that has been outlined by the AAOU Secretariat, I decided that we should take a look at these outputs so that we know what do we want to achieve. And these considerations are important because they then re-inform your paradigm, because your paradigm must also consider what is the obligations that you have when you embark on a research project. Now, I like to divide these into research grants, research publications, postgraduates, intellectual properties, commercialization and services, and social innovation. When we think about research fundings, research fundings are obtained from different resources. First resource could be internal, which means the university to where you are a student or you're a staff, academic staff, and can also get obtained from the government. And from the government, these funding can be offered to various ministries, various agencies. All you have to do is you have to search under each of the ministries, what are the priorities that are given. Now, one of the main things you need to learn is whenever you seek for a funding, each funding, if it's a government funding, the government funding has national priorities. So the national priorities will outline what is important for the government. And also for the universities, they also have the organizational priorities. So these are priorities that is set and governs the funding. So from these priorities, you could also decide what are the influencing factors that forms your research paradigm as well. So it is not a one-way road, but I think there are many aspects that could inform your research paradigm. Now, you also could apply for international funding agency, for example, European Commission, have various different forms of program, various different forms of program then informs on the various expectation and outcomes. You also have UNESCO, you have the IDRC, which is from the government of Canada, you have Japan Foundation. So why I use this is that sometimes the funding comes from a single organization. Sometimes it comes from specifically from one country to another. Sometimes the funding comes from one organization, but then it has many different funders within the organization. There's also funding from industry. This is a picture that is taken from at one of the university that gives a depiction of the nature of the fundings that they have. They're from federal government, from state government. So altogether, you can see large funding come from government. And then the university itself is a very small percentage and a small percentage that comes from industry and nonprofit. Now, these are not necessarily the same for every country or every organization for that matter. So it can be different. Now, here is one of the agents from United Nations, the joint funders that contribute to the funding that is provided by UNESCO. Now, I take a picture here from the European Commission for just to show you how the priorities will look like. So for every funding, for example, you can have their pillars or their objective. So for example, pillar one, the fundings are targeted for excellence in science. And pillar two focuses on global challenges and European industrial competitiveness. Finally, pillar three is innovative Europe. So you can have such priority for national funding, even institutional funding, institutional or industrial funding. Every funding will have its own priorities. So this also will inform where your research paradigm and research objectives could fall in. Now, this is publication. The world of publication is important. You, as an output, where would you like to publish? In index or non-index? And why is this important? Because your publication determines the objective of your research as well. Because what are you trying to achieve in the research? Is it scholarly work? Is it capacity building? Would you just like to share? What are the objectives for these research that, and then it forms also back to your research paradigm. And then postgraduate students. Postgraduate students are very important because postgraduate students are the human resource that you would, this is training of human resource for the institution, for the country, and for the global world. In that, you must see postgraduate students as also the resource that contributes to body of knowledge and also to newer ideas. And also, finally, they form the knowledge society that we would like and we need, particularly in this region, in order for us to become a developed country. So you can have postgraduate students involved in various activities. I think it's very important for the university to expose postgraduate students for research fundings, publications, as well as for the next criteria that I'm going to show. So there are also fellowships that are available for postgraduate students. Everywhere that you read, if you attend a symposium, if you read a magazine, or if you apply for a fellowship, all these have priorities. The priorities can inform you what are the main global issues that are current in today's world. Intellectual properties. Now, why intellectual properties are important? Intellectual property refers to trademark, copyright, patents, design, so many things that are that actually protects the work that you produce. And then on one side, you also have open science. What are the information and knowledge that you like to share with the public? Common good. Yeah. So both are important, and you need to have a balance in the research output. All these will also inform your thought process as you derive to your own research paradigm. Where do you strike a balance? Yeah? Now, why we talked about intellectual property? Because intellectual property is your resource in order for you to produce to move towards commercialization of your product or process or services that you have innovated and offer that services to the public. So from science, you move to the legal aspect of the protection and then move to business for value creation. So all these are important because we live in a society that we need to work, we need to live, we need to also protect. So, and finally, the last of the contribution that we need to have within the research projects that we do is the social innovation. Now, social innovation, just a glimpse about what we need to do to guide. So one of it is we need to identify real problems. What are the real problems that the society where you live in is facing? And then you need to connect with your community. And then you need to collaborate. You need to take actions. Words alone, proposal alone, concepts alone will not produce results unless you take actions. And with the actions, action alone is not enough. You need to also study the impact of your actions. So those are what forms this social innovation. Now, from all these aspects, you need to think about these are the things that you need to produce. Now, in order to need to produce all these, you then revert back to your paradigm and think about your paradigm. What are the changes? What are the important things that you're missing in your original paradigm or your original thought process that forms your research method? Yeah. So it's a cycle. And here, before we think about global research paradigm, one of the most important things and the foundation for transdisciplinary is the partnership for the goals. Here, I like to quote partnership SDG Goal 17, and some of these three targets are defined here because it talks about the kind of collaboration needed in order for us to have an impactful outcome. Yeah. And current global crisis, the couple current issues that we have, we need to, these are just a guideline. Yeah. One of the main thing and concern that we have, particularly as we are moving towards 2030, is how to build a sustainable future. So research should be geared towards this. And the world becoming more and more digital. So societal well-being in a digital world is also a priority. And we also have, in a world that is becoming, changing very drastically and frequently, we also need to think take a look at the future skills, because the future skills changes. Every year we look into these future skills. You can find all these available if you're concerned about, am I going to be relevant in the future? Then you can take a look at the future skills. There are skills that are IT-based, there are skills people-based, and some of the future skills are highlighted here. Also, other areas that are becoming more prevalent is risk management and solutions. So risk and securities is important area of studies that is, you can see a lot of focus is given today. In fact, ISO 9001 has a new addition to the criteria that is being looked at, which is the risk detection. And then we also have energy crisis. Energy is always an important area of studies. And with the world, much of the problem are associated with energy. And the other thing that we need to understand is the relationship between energy and economic growth. And energy is also an important, which is actually SDG 7 that talks about the type of energy and energy efficiency that we need in order to create a better world. And finally, it's not actually finally, because you have other global issues. Yeah, these are not limited to the ones that I've just highlighted. Climate change is important area of study. We need to look into the mitigation. We need to look into adaptation. What I'm trying to do here is give you possible areas for you to consider, and the selection of the area then forms the kind of research paradigm you need to have for your research, then which then forms your methodology. Now, in this slide, I've just put a few words in order for us to look into the impact on the education. we understand the current world, the current setting kind of promotes open science. It fosters open education framework, and that we need to come up with innovative learning space, because one of the big challenges we used to have as open and distance learning institutions would be to have practical session. Now, having innovative learning space like immersive learning that Prof. Gorky has mentioned opens up opportunities for newer experiences. And we also could, with the technology, come up with more creative media. But creativity must lead to effectiveness. Yeah? And universal design learning is important in order for us to bridge the gap in terms of it's a way to address the diversity and the issues that we have, like digital gaps as well. Now, having these thoughts, the question is for education is that, do we need a new learning theory today, or do we need a new research paradigm? Those are some of the thought-provoking questions that I leave you with. And this is it's just an image of the future skill profile, and you can see how interesting. In a way, it looks a little complicated. There are many aspects, many criteria that you can see: digital literacy, learning literacy, self-efficacy. But what is important here, I'd like to highlight, is that you see how everything is connected, and that's the main theme that has to be prevalent in the current global research philosophy, research paradigm. And with that, I'd like to thank everyone for being here. And if you have would like to have further communication, you can contact me at the email address that I've stated here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Thirumani, for your detailed and enriching presentation on this topic. So now we are moving to Q&A session, where we will have questions from the participants of this webinar, and we'll request our speakers to answer those questions. So I would request if we can have some if we have some questions. So yeah. So thank you. Yanto from UT have a question for Professor Gorky, that there are a huge number of articles about, for example, emergency remote learning among high school students. The methods and results are some are different, some are same. So I'm interested to conduct a research about it in my school. Can you suggest how to make my research different from the previous research? What should I consider? I'm afraid my research will reduplicate the previous findings.
Okay, thank you, Bapak Yanto, Mr. Yanto from Universitas Terbuka. First of all, we have to be able to differentiate between open flexible distance learning, or previously we call it distant learning or distant education or online learning or whatever the name. But in a sense, emergency remote teaching is different from distant education. So later on, at least there are three things that should be taken into account cautiously. What would be the problems that arise as a result of moving from offline to online learning? The first one is whether it is pedagogically adaptable. And the second, what would be the design for learning materials, so delivery mode of learning, and then the evaluation system. And the third one, let's say technicality and technological support. So if you later on want to see how to differentiate or how to avoid the emergency remote teaching rather than distant learning as applied by the whole world, so those three things should be first taken into account. So I repeat once again about the pedagogy and then the readiness of the all academic services. And the last one, technological or technicality support, means that if one of these three things is not there, means you are not in the online learning mode or not in the OFDL learning mode, but still in emergency remote teaching. How to visualize about emergency remote teaching? Let's say if you usually or if you conduct your teaching session, for example, in class, and then you put it, for example, into a Zoom, for example. That's mean that there are no pedagogical approach over there, and also the technicalities and also the technological support is not supportive enough. And then the prepared learning materials or academic support or academic services is not there. So you must see these three things first to avoid the emergency remote teaching. So if you want to have such research, for example, you may approach that by let's say qualitative or quantitative. If you see it as a quantitative approach, for example, you may have the conceptual framework first, and then you translate into an operational framework. From the operational framework, you make the what sort of variables involved, which one the dependent and which one is dependent or mediating variables. And then later on, you put all the indicators, and then you develop it into questions or statements, and then give it to the your respondents. And if it is a qualitative approach, for example, you may use, let's say, you observe, and then you see case by case, student per students, or schools per schools. But if you want to apply, as suggested by Professor Subramanian just now, you may see it from positivism, for example, and then for realism or pragmatism. And then you see later on from the ontology, epistemology, and also axiology. Then you may have a very, a very broad perspective, such that you may choose later on whether it is qualitative, quantitative, for example, versus qualitative, or you have a mix, and then see it from positivism, for example, realism, pragmatism, or interpretivism. And then by doing so, you will be ready to develop an article later on as a result of your research to be published in the reputable international journal. I hope that answered your question. But the three things, at least, you have to see it as a how to find your research gaps from those three point of view. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Gorky. Can we say that if we understand the problem in detail in your situation, like what problem you are actually trying to solve, and your context can make this problem unique one, and you will not duplicate the already done researches. So just understand your context, like in what context you want to do something, and are there possible solutions already available, or you are trying something, you know, some unique solution, or this already available solution can present some novel challenges in that situation?
If you may formulate that kind of framework in a conceptual framework, it is not so difficult to find your novelty. Novelty later on. For example, the novelty, it doesn't mean that you don't have something before and then suddenly you have something new. No, it is not like that. But as long as you may add from the previous one, maybe it is from the conceptual, theoretical, for example, operational or methodological or practical, so it will lead us to the place where we can you said just now, the unique one. So you must understand first the uniqueness of your if it's into the institution, if it is about the scope of the research, it is the scope of research. So there will be no duplication, for example, as you said just now. Yeah. So make sure, just now, Professor Subramaniam, let's say, give us a perspective how to avoid the duplication. But it doesn't mean that we can we cannot duplicate later on after we finish our research. But before we doing our research, we have to make sure that this is unique to our context. So start from the problems. The problems we can formulate from the research gaps. And the research gaps, for example, as Pak Yanto just now said, maybe about how to view whether it is distant learning, for example, versus emergency remote teaching. As long as we know that conceptually, so it is not too hard to find the operational framework if it is from a quantitative approach, for example, later on, or from a qualitative. As long as we know what our problem is. Back to you.
Thank you.
Dr. Tupai.
Can we have a question displayed on the screen, please? Okay, our next question is from Siti from UT. You mentioned this question is for Professor Gorky. You mentioned about research gap in your last slide. How do I find research gap? Do you think that every research must be able to produce findings that can fill in the research gap? I think it's something related to previous question as well. So yeah, please, over to you.
Okay, thank you, Ibu Siti. Even I said just now that there should be a research gap, it doesn't mean that if you don't have a research gap, you cannot do a research. No, not really like that. But if we have a research gap as our foundation of developing further steps, it will lead us to find out what would be the objective, how we solve the problems, for example, and how we choose the appropriate methodology for that. So, let's say in the first place, we have to find out the problems. Whether it is from a research gap or not, it is not really important for the first stage. But if you want to go further to find a novelty, for example, so there will be a research gap. And how we equip ourselves so that we can find a research gap. As I said before, that the research gap could be found from conceptual level, from theoretical, from empirical, from methodological, and from practical. The toughest one, or the highest one, if you like, that's from the conceptual and the theoretical one. But if you cannot, or I cannot find the research gap from conceptual or theoretical level, I may use from the methodological, for example, from the empirical, or from the practical. If I say about the practical level, it is not too hard to find the research gap. For example, let's say I'm teaching economics for postgraduate, for example. I predict that 80% of the student would be passed. 20% out of 80% the student that pass would be in a grade A, and 30% in grade B, and so on. From that frame of thinking, so if I teach them and then I deliver the lecture, for example, and then I assess if I got the same prediction, for example, 80% passed the exams, and then 20% out of 80% got A, for example. So it implies that I arrange all the lectures up to the delivery and also the assessment in line with what I'm thinking of, whether it's from pedagogical perspective, technical perspective, or from teaching and learning perspective. But if I predict that 80% of them will pass, and then less than 60%, that's the gap. If I see how come I predict 80% of them are passing, have a good grade, for example, ABC, and then only 60%. So the gaps is whether it is because of the academic or non-academic. If it is about academic, whether it is about the learning materials or learning support services or from assessment aspect or another. So by having that kind of inquiry, first inquiry, so we will come to the research problems that will lead to a research question. And then from that research question, it is hoped that we'll be able to find out the keywords, how to solve the problems. And from the keywords, we can find how the methodology that works upon our problems. So that's how we try to find the research gap from practical level, from methodology level. Methodological level, for example, how you deliver, whether it's from by using, let's say, project-based learning, for example, or inquiry model, or other approach in teaching. Or if it is from the practical, let's say, whether you have a very, very complete learning support, built from a technical perspective and also from theoretical and later on from the conceptual framework. That's how we try to find the uniqueness of our research, and then we find it from a research gap. Yeah, back to you, Dr. Tuvail.
Thank you so much, Professor Gorky. As the professor mentioned, we have different types of gaps. So we have to find out like what gap actually we want to fill in, like theoretical, conceptual, methodological, practical, data type, like, et cetera. Yeah. So can we have next question? Thank you so much. Okay, we have our question for Dr. Thirumeni, and we have question from Arena UT. Any example you can provide to conduct research concerning the SDGs, as you mentioned, that can be implemented by me as I'm going to write a thesis in the field of elementary.
Yeah. Thank you. So elementary education, when you talk about, first of all, I think the education concerning the concept of sustainability is important. So you need to look into, I don't really know exactly what kind of research focus you want to have, whether you want to look into the curriculum or you want to look into the pedagogy. That will determine exactly what you want to do. But I think if you talk about SDG, the challenges are to understand the concepts. What does the word sustainability means? How do you define development for your own? Because developmental definition is subject to each country. And then you need to teach these learners all the sustainable development goals. And at elementary levels can be quite challenging because much of the goals are government oriented, but you find a way to teach. So but how you design, so again, it depends on the, but the bigger challenge is actually achievement of the sustainable development goals. So in terms of elementary school, will be more to finding solutions or looking at solutions that individuals could do so that the children have an understanding how to lead a more sustainable lifestyle and make, effective choices about their life. I hope that answered the questions.
Thank you, Professor. I just would like to add one thing, like what is the problem actually? First, you have to identify that, like in the elementary context, what is the problem related to SDGs? First, I think we should look in that, and that, as you mentioned, like, what are your theoretical and obviously conceptual definitions of those terms? Do you have any more questions? Okay, thank you. So our question is for Professor Gorky Vinoto from UT. I'm going to do the research entitled The Influence of the Project-Based Learning Model on English Language Teaching Towards the Students' Engagement and Achievement in Tunas Bangsa Junior High School Lagoi Bintan. Is it still relevant to the current issues in global educational research? Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Pak Winoto. Later on, maybe Ibu Subramaniam will add from Malaysia perspective about the student engagement. As far as I noticed the about the engagement, I think whether it is in the mode of offline or online, student engagement, especially in junior high schools, it is always relevant. Why? Because we are not talking only about cognitive presence in one hand and teaching presence on the other hand. There should be another one. I call it emotional engagement. And emotional engagement refers to students physically and socially. So if I'm asked whether the influence of the project-based learning on English language teaching toward the student engagement, it will always be relevant, especially when you are going to have a research if it is based on online mode of learning. Why is it so? When we are in the classroom, it is not too hard to find out whether the students engage socially or physically. But when we are talking about online learning through media mediated by, let's say, Zoom, for example, like what we are doing now, it becomes a problem how to assure that the students fully engage. So there will be approach apart from cognitive presence in one hand, I repeat it once again, and teaching presence on the other hand. So later on, if you want to see how relevant this topic of research, especially in student engagement, you will see later on that even though you have a very good teacher who can build or who can equip all the classroom with cognitive presence and teaching presence, if the teacher is not able to fully engage the students, the effectiveness of the learning in terms of their performance, academic performance, would be less than expected. So I'm happy if you're going to do this kind of research on student engagement, but don't forget, student engagement can be divided into two parts, his or her social engagement or emotional engagement. Another one is his physical. It doesn't mean that even you are in the classroom physically, but it doesn't mean that emotionally you were there. So there will be a way of a new way of working or new way of thinking how to make them simultaneously socially or emotionally and physically there in the class and engaged to the learning process. Thank you, Pak Winoto.
Thank you, Professor. Do we have more questions? Okay, so we have our next question for Professor Tirumeni, Lina Jakarta. Referring to your slide, to me, finding the real problem is challenging. I teach English, and when I find that my students are not so enthusiastic to learn and master English, I think the problem is because they think English is difficult. I don't know what else that make them uninterested to learn English. Can you suggest how to trigger me finding the real problem? I'm planning to explore this for my thesis.
Thank you. I think you already spell your real problem within the question because you're already saying that your students' motivation are low, and that is the real problem. And again, you also say that they think English is difficult. Therefore, you also have another problem to address, which is the conception that they have about the language. So you have two problems already which are real and situational to where you are teaching. So I think the finding the problem is already there. Now you need to read up a lot and describe and understand the population that you have in order to contextualize what is the research paradigm that you want like to adopt. And the toughest thing I think is to come up with the strategies that would then trigger and improve their level of motivation into learning English. I just like to just a short story to maybe motivate you, because I have a friend who is a teacher trainer, and we just went to a school, a primary school, to look at the school, and as we were walking, we saw a few boys, about six of them, primary school boys, just sitting outside the toilet there and not learning. You know, they quit their classes and were there, and then my friend asked them and everything, and then they told that they quit English class because they don't want to learn English. And within 5 minutes, my friend is, you know, she talked to them, and next thing you know, the boys are singing English songs, learning new words, and it's how you motivate them doing things that they like that changes their perception towards the language. So I think you could, I'm very sure you are able to do that with your students. Best of luck with your students. And one other thing for everyone who's doing education, you should always include the term as Sustainable Development Goal in terms of SDG 4, because SDG 4 is to achieve quality education for everyone. So that is your linkage to the Sustainable Development Goals. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor.
Dr. Tufail, can I add some sure. my contribution to Lina,
sure.
Following what just now said by Dr. Subramaniam? I'm not an English teacher, but I'm learning English before I go abroad, for example. So this is a real experience. In my opinion, I'm not good also in language because I'm a mathematics logical learner. And then I found out that when I was taught by the English teacher, I found out two things. The first one about the structure, let's say structure means that all the things about the learning materials, and then the exposure. The exposure refers to how the teacher delivered the materials in English. And then, on the other hand, I see that there are at least two variables influence how students success in learning English, for example. The first one on the his or her personal, and then the second one from institutional sector. Now, I want to add what Dr. Subramaniam said just now about the teacher, the tools, and the strategy. When we are talking about teacher tools and strategy, refer to the exposure, not for the structure, the learning materials. So by having this kind of understanding, when I was taught English about 25 years ago, as long as the structure in line with the exposure, it helps a student, even though the student is not in the language mode of learning. It helps. But it doesn't mean that if you teach somebody else, will be finished in 6 months for, let's say, 500 score tuple. But for me, maybe it takes twice than that. But at least, as long as we can, as a teacher, as long as you can put yourself that the structure and exposure should be in line in one hand, on the other hand, the epistemological factors means the epistemological refers to prerequisite knowledge about the English, because it should be like a building block process. So if we have some kind of a structure like that, so it will help the student, even though the student is not in the language learning mode. That's my experience when I have to take more than one and a half year only to pass 500 TOEFL score about 35 or 30 years ago, because I'm not in the linguistic learning mode. Thank you.
Thank you. Can we have next question, please? Okay, our next question is for both of our speakers. From UT master's degree program student, I'm writing a research proposal now. The sample of my research are teachers of kindergarten in my city. Altogether, there are 70 teachers. I'm planning to use quantitative method and data collection is by questionnaire. My colleague said, as the population is only 70, my research should be qualitative and data collection is by interview. 70 people is too small for a quantitative research. So please share your point of view on this.
Thank you for the question. Well, your colleagues are right in that. But I think you have to look into many things because you're looking at the population within these are convenient sampling, yeah? So the teachers of your kindergartens in your city. So your number could be limited. And then depends on the kind of quest data that you're collecting. If you're using questionnaire, you can still use questionnaire, but you need to have open-ended questions. So, but I think you really need to talk to your supervisor to get your supervisor's advice on your research methodology. There is a real concern to what your colleagues have said to you. So you need to consider your approach in terms of collecting your data. Thank you. Unless Gorky, you have something to add on.
Okay. I thought it's only for you. First of all, the approach of research is only a tool. So don't depend on the tools, but depend on the gaps, problems, and your title. As long as the title is not ask you or force you to have a quantitative, why should you do quantitative? After all, you only have 70 respondents later on. But methodically, even if you only have 70 respondents, you still able to do it by using quantitative approach. Apart from the questionnaire is open-ended, as Subramaniam said just now, you can use also later on with partial least square structural equation model. So it does. Usually, we have to have the number of respondents should be in line with the number of your parameters. The other one,
population.
Population. Yeah. But if you use a PLSM, there will be a statistical manipulation in a positive meaning. Not in the manipulation is not in the negative meaning. You may still have, but better you use a mixed method. You use a qualitative, and then from that qualitative result later on, you may use or you may reassess by using a quantitative one. Means that you have to use the exploratory design. Means you do it qualitative first, and then followed by a quantitative. Usually, if I ask my student like that, they said, "Oh, this is too hard for me." No, it is only a tool. It depends on your problem. It is useless if you force yourself to use quantitative. Then your problem should be approached with a qualitative one. So put it this way: use a mixed method, use the exploratory design, and then you do it qualitative first with open-ended, as Subramaniam suggested just now. And then later on, after that, you use, even though with a very limited number of respondents, you may use it as not a real test, but only to make sure that you are on the right track, your qualitative results are more or less supported by your quantitative result. That's how we usually approach. If the respondent is not quite big or not quite enough from statistical point of view. But if you use later on the PLS-SEM, even though you have only 60 to 70 respondents, as long as you already have the qualitative results, you may use that just to check whether you are on the right track or not.
I'm glad you said what you said, Prof, because one of the big dilemma I find in social sciences is that sometimes people are so fixated on the method, like they say, oh, I'm only going to do quanti or I'm going to do quali. But the important thing is, what is your research question? What is your objectives? Yeah. So I think that's more important.
Thank you, respected speakers. Can we have next question, please? Okay, two questions. Professor, we have Vidya Rizki Prithvi from UT, and for Professor Thirumani, in the light of global digital divide, how can educational research paradigms address the discrepancies in technology access and digital literacy between different regions and socioeconomic groups? And Professor Gorky, what new research paradigms are possibly emerging to address the challenges and opportunities presented by evolving landscape of education, such as the rise of technology? So I think we can have one by one. Like, I would like to invite like Dr. Thirumani for the answer, please.
Please unmute. Okay, thank you.
I'm glad this question is asked today, because this is one of the dilemma that we have, because as you want to promote technology access, but we also understand the regional and socioeconomic gaps that exist. So there isn't a solution. So that is one solution for all. And that is why the universal design principle or learning principles are important. So in designing a solution, then you need to have a solution that is unique and cater for all group of learners. So for example, if you have a digital content and then you have an issue with access, then you must make sure that those access are available to the learners who do not have access. So that meaning that your content are available in various formats. So in terms of how the educational research paradigm will differ, then what are your pillars in your paradigm? What is the objective? Is it equal access? So all these things will form the educational paradigm that comes with the challenges of providing a solution that is available to all group of people. And there are interesting solutions for whenever there is an issue with digital access. I think countries like India, for example, have a lot of resource entrepreneurial solutions that caters for people with digital divide, digital issues with digital access. They are two different things, access and then there's also the divide. Yeah. So I hope that answers your question. I could pass that to Prof. Gorky now.
Okay, Vidya, since you are from Indonesia, so I will try to put the background of the or traditional from Indonesia context. Whether we like it or not, disruptions leads to uncertainty in one hand. On the other hand, starting from, let's say, 2020 to the future, learners, whether it is in the mode of face-to-face or distant learning or open flexible, would be millennials and Gen Z. So if you ask me, what would, as a result of evolving landscape of education, in terms of technological advancement, for example. So at least if we see mode of learning for millennials or Gen Z, it was totally different compared to us. Let's say for me, I'm 66 years old now. So I don't recognize at all how the current Gen Z learning. So the first one, what kind of mode of learning would be suitable in the next 5 to 10 years for the millennials or Gen Z? That's the first one. And the second one, what kind of teaching and learning context or modes appropriate for them? In my time, I was pushed or I was forced for 3.5 years, hours in the classroom, and no problem for me, because at the time, that's the mode of learning. But now, even you are provided with, let's say, a very good comedy, for example, if it takes you more than 20 minutes, it doesn't work at all. You don't laugh anymore. Compare it if it is about knowledge, about learning. It becomes worse, I guess. So the teaching and learning context or learning modes, very crucial for us, whether it is from for the face-to-face or online learning modes, to find out what would be the appropriate one or suitable for our future millennials or Gen Z or students. And the third one, what would be the model of assessment? So, if we are given for these three modes of learning, teaching and learning context or modes of delivery mode, for example, and the assessment, that would be very huge challenge for us. How to put all the academic package for our millennials or Gen Z as a result of disruption, where disruption leads to uncertainty. And then, I was telling that if we cannot teach the student now anymore, then we have to follow how they learn, how they study. Otherwise, we'll talk to the walls.
Well now, said.
So, don't worry about the educational landscape evolving. That's a sunatullah. It's okay. Just receive it as a risky from God. Yeah. Now, how we put ourselves so we are on the same boat with all the future students. So again, if Bu Widya, if you want to have a kind of a futuristic research in this field, for example, about mode of learning, teaching and learning context or mode, and assessment models, and then make it in line with our Gen Z. Thank you.
Thank you, respected speakers. Do we have any more questions, please?
Excuse me, Dr. Mubashara, because we are running out of time. We cannot read the rest of the questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, respected participants, for attending this very, very interesting webinar. If you have some questions which is not yet answered, I would suggest reaching out to AAOU Secretariat through email, and they may connect you with the speakers and you can have your question answered. So, from now, thank you so much, Professor Dr. Gorky and Professor Dr. Tirumini, for your insightful presentations. And it was a very good experience to have you on this virtual event with us. We have discussed the recent issues in the field of education, global research paradigm, in the context of global research paradigm. So it was a very interesting and very enriching event to attend. So beside that, I would also like to thank you, our participants who were very active during this event, and they asked some interesting questions so that we can further deliberate on this topic. And I would also extend my thanks to AAOU Secretariat for their very detailed in time and very just in time and just in need support for arranging this event. So thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Mubashara. I also thank to Professor Gorky and Dr. Tiru, and also the president, Professor Ojata Rojat. For information that actually we still have 4 to 5 more questions, and then we will upload it in our YouTube, and then we would like ask Professor Gorky and Dr. Tiru to check our YouTube, and then you can give further answers. And then hopefully, if you still have questions, you can you can post it in our YouTube. Now, I would like to continue to the next session. And then as a form of appreciation, I would like to, thank you, Prof. Gorky, award the certificate. The first one is to Professor Dr. Maximus Gorky Sembiring. And then this is, once again, this is the form of our appreciation from the Secretariat. And then if you need the printed, we can provide it for you because you are in UTE. The next most welcome, Prof. And the next one, she would like to give the certificate to Dr. Tiru Subramaniam. Once again, thank you very much for responding to our invitation. And then the last one, I would like to present the certificate to Dr. Mubashara Taufir. Once again, your contribution to the first lecture series is very valuable, and then we learn a lot from three of you. Once again, thank you very much. And then for the speakers, for the participants, I would like to remind you that the AAOU journal is waiting for your contribution. Please send your best article to the editors. You can check the website. And then, as we mentioned in the beginning of the program, the AAOU journal is now indexed in Scopus, and then it is in Q1. So, and then once again, that the AAOU journal is published 3 times a year. So once again, to those who are participating this lecture series, would like to invite you to send your best article. And then also I would like to remind you that the next AAOU conference, the 37th AAOU conference, will be held in Allama Iqbal Open University. Please check it regularly in the AAOU website, and then your in-person participation in Islamabad is welcome. Next, this is the feedback. This is mandatory for all participants who are requiring the certificate. You must complete the feedback. And then the feedback is available for 3 hours up to, from now on. Once again, for all participants who wish to have certificate, please complete the feedback. And then we will send the certificate to your email. Once again, thank you very much for speakers, moderators, and also participants. See you next month in the second lecture series with a more interesting topic. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye. Dr. Tufail, see you in Pakistan by the end of this year.
As
a host, host of AAOU annual conference.
Okay. Thank you so much.
My regards to friends in OUM, Ibu Thiru.
Oh, terima kasih, Pak.
Long time no see.
Betul. Last kita akan bertemu di Pakistan nanti.
Sudah lama tidak ke Malaysia. terakhir ya. Dengan Pak Mansur Fadzil.
Pak Mansur sehat, ya, dia di rumah sekarang sudah ganti.
Oke, salam sama
semua. Saya akan kirim salam kat dia.
Ya. Ya. Yeah. Oke, okay. Sampai ketemu. Bye bye all. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Tiru.
Thank you.
Bye bye.